circulated over 6 million items and introduced Sunday openings in all 10 of our branches. Response to the Sunday service has been overwhelming. People do vote with their feet, and branches are full to the roster, particularly here in Hope Bay. The Greater Victoria Public Library System is one of the highest per capita usage rates in the country, and over 79% of the population of Greater Victoria have library cards. And that's a very, very high percentage compared to anywhere else. I also want to remind you that, you know, introducing Sunday openings is something that the public really wanted. And it was a hard thing to do because it was a cost item, but it's, and now having done it for a couple of years, we realize how significant that has been to the community. It has been a very positive thing in our mind, but of course, it's the time of cost pressures, it's always been significant. So we value your support in that regard, because I think it's an important factor for Oak Bay. As noted by our Minister of Education, the public library demand continues to increase during difficult economic times. We find that the public libraries are a valued asset in meeting the community's strategic needs, as the community members value and have access to the opportunities that are available within the library. I'm not sure if all of you are big users of the library or not, but I think it's important that you know that libraries have shifted over the years. We're much more than the bricks and mortar institutions now. In fact, we're way more than books. We offer programs, partnership opportunities, personal development opportunities, literacy support, and digital access to information. We're guides in a very congested information landscape. Our patrons attend author readings, use our public computers, attend a story program for families, borrow a novel in Cantonese, receive home delivery of library materials from volunteers, attend a business workshop, or simply borrow a book in whatever format they choose for self-improvement or personal enjoyment. The shift to the digital side has really been significant as well. I don't know if you've been reading about, or any of you are e-book readers or Kobo readers, or if you've managed to download books electronically from the library, that's certainly a growth area that we're heavily involved in. The Oak Bay community usage rates of library services are one of the highest levels in the GVPL system. Programs such as Reading Buddies have waiting lists, and our March break programming is oversubscribed. Library management will be working with city staff to ensure the library can further support these user needs by considering how we can move forward on the priorities identified in our facilities plan. Over the last couple of years, the library has created a significant strategic plan and facilities plan, and it's working significantly in those new directions. You've all received our final budget in the package. The trend this council congratulated on us on last year continues to be maintained. The 2012 library operating budget increases a modest 2.9%. This represents a 4.32% municipal contribution increase overall, down from last year's 4.95%. This has been achieved through stringent review by staff and board to identify cost savings and efficiencies. Our amazing staff continue to contain expenditures. However, revenue from fines and provincial funding is declining. We implemented a system to get books back, which has been good for getting books back, but it's reduced the amount of money we get because books are coming back. So that's a reality we've had to live with. And our budget acquisition for materials, therefore, has suffered. As the Victoria Foundation's 2011 Vital Signs report indicates, our spaces are heavily used, and as a result, facilities and equipment need continuous maintenance and upgrades. I'd like to conclude my remarks by expressing my sincere appreciation to Council for your continued support, and to commend the library staff for their diligence in achieving so much with so little. We really have cut to the bone, and that budget, board, and staff have achieved has not come easily. Staff will be challenged this year to implement these efficiencies while continuing to respond to the changing nature of library service and the increasing needs in our community. As a board, we are committed to exploring new sources of revenue. As noted in our budget cover letter, we have established a development committee of the board to establish new effort on development and fundraising activities. We know we need money, so we're developing procedures and methods and initiatives to find money from the community. Essentially, it's many ways to find fundraising efforts and find ways for members of the community to contribute voluntarily to services that the Victoria Library offers. We've launched a dynamic new three-year strategic plan, which reflects the changing conditions, the two new technology that are in place, and increasing public demand that is informing the changing nature of our service delivery. We're changing the way we do business, just as we've always done, to meet our user needs. Now, the real experts here are not me. I'm sure you'll know it'll be Maureen and Donna and Lynn and Patricia who will be able to answer any of the more detailed questions regarding any details that you have. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. We didn't get it all, no, and that's why, you know, I mean, we have a lot of work to do here in the CRD, but we're doing not too bad this year. We're about 20% more than we were last year. So despite some of the problems that we have here, including, you know, as I mentioned in my, I don't want to reiterate what I've said, but, you know, the economic downturn hit us hard, certainly the Canadian dollar being at par when we service mostly LA producers has hit us quite hard, and not getting our 6% tax credit in the CRD has been a real problem that we're looking at trying to overcome as well. But we did manage to bring some pretty exciting shows last year. We had Cupcake Girls, we had Dragon's Den, we brought both of those here. We had a fairly big movie shoot called Big Time Movie that was in town shooting, and we did about 22 productions here, and a whole lot of local producers helping them out as well. Movie, including a feature film that we helped Victoria Westcott make, and I think actually Victoria is a resident of Oak Bay. Her family certainly is. And she did a movie called Locked in a Garage Band, which ended up taking her to last year's Oscars because of the connections that she made, certainly not through me, but we did help her make that movie. We also have had another local film producer help him make a feature film that he's still working on called Jackhammer, and a lot of others, 13 episodes of with Karen Davies of Cedarwood Productions. She does Flavors of the West Coast, which some of you might know. We work on constantly with local independent producers and providing them not only with crew and recommendations, but also with workshops as well, and bringing in BC Film last year to do a workshop with local producers on how to access BC film funding and tax credit funding.
Discussion, all in favor? Opposed? None opposed? Thank you very much. And okay. let's pursue that idea.
Okay, all right.
Your people call our people. Now we have the Community Social Planning Council, a request for financial assistance, which is a mere $39 more than last year. Last year we gave them $2,924. Anyone from that group? Were there any questions when you were looking at this that you might want Ms. Walker to write about? Discussion, all in favor, opposed, none opposed. Thank you. St. John Ambulance. Most of us say St. John's Ambulance. I'm not quite sure why, but it's...
You know, most people say St. John's, and I kind of...
I know. I was careful not to. Are you...
Yeah, my name is Ross Nichols. I'm Vice Chair of the Grants Executive Committee, and I guess because I'm a unicorn, and also I'm actually representing the Medical First Responder
Thank you. Thank you for the great work you do. We see you everywhere, at every event, it seems. Is there questions? Well, people are thinking, I have a question on your the St. John Ambulance Victoria Branch Statement of Revenues and Expenditures. The breakdown of revenues was kind of all conglomerated by the looks of it in that. and I wasn't able to extract what we've given and what other communities have given and how, where we are in the pack. And you could address that. And I should say, last year you received 571, and I think this year you're asking for 1,000. I should have mentioned that at the top. Okay.
To answer both those, firstly, this is the first year I've done this application, and I've given a lot of grief to our folks in our regional office and provincial office in Vancouver about the format of those statements. It goes from gaming to the United Way to whatever, and it's not very friendly for making a presentation like this.
Can you move a little closer to the microphone?
Oh, sorry. So hopefully next year we'll have a more clear format for presenting those numbers. The municipal grants are actually included in a line that says other revenue, which is other income.
Okay. That's 24,957.
Which is misleading because that's partly income to the volunteer side and partly income to the business side. Last year we received about $8,300 from various municipalities in the area, and the rough breakdown for that was roughly $5,000 from Victoria, about $3,000 from Saanich,
this is not a memory test.
Oh,
so
2,000%.
But what we could probably ask you to do, we could ask you to do probably, is if you would send a note to us on that follow up, because I think it's of some significance to us as to, particularly when you're going to be asking quite 50% increase, but a significant increase. So are there any questions other than that? Then? Okay, move to it's going to go to estimates. Seconded. All in favor? Opposed? Thank you very much, Mr. Nichols. And if we can get that information from you, there is a when is the deadline for us receiving?
The history of this, if it turned off again now. This needs to
consolidate all the crisis lines on the island into one location, and they were the most significant. They were a large funder of that, and they decided on Central Island for a number of reasons. And so we made the tactical decision to close down the line. But we were providing other services. We were providing suicide education in schools. And we were providing the web support for youth, and we were doing other suicide prevention initiatives, and we didn't want to see those. We we didn't want to see Victoria lose those services, so the board made the decision to keep going and focus on those areas. Access line, we operated 24/7 with about 100 volunteers at any given time. When crisis line closed down, most of the volunteers chose to basically say their goodbyes. That was an intense involvement for all of them, and what was quite a lot of meeting that went on when it closed down. What we are continuing with is the suicide prevention, which has a much smaller number of volunteers. There are about 10 at present. And then youth space, which is open from 6 to 11 every night. And we started out after the crisis line closed down with about 5 volunteers. We're up to 10. We've got 15 currently in training. And so there's still a high volunteer component in terms of the service delivery itself. And the staffing is more focused on recruiting, training, and supporting those volunteers, as well as keeping a hand in some of the direct service as needs be.
How many staff are there?
There are
full-time.
Full-time? Just two. There's 7 in total, so most of them are part-time.
That seems like a high number. But
that includes benefits and.
Yeah, the two numbers I was just curious about was that aren't clear is the $20,000 for programs, which I wasn't sure what that it was, how that was separate, and then the $26,000 for accommodations.
Right. This is the overall budget for the agency, and the programs and services. Include volunteer expenses and also web costs and maintaining the website, which in this case is part of our doing business model. And it also includes internet service and that kind of thing. And accommodation.
Agency. I have worked with Nate off and on, not as a volunteer, but in another life as a professional, probably when it was founded 38 years ago. So we go back a long way. This is an amazing service, and it was a real loss to this community when it was moved to Nanaimo. And I remember that because she came up to North Saanich to request assistance at that time, I think. Yeah. So, I would certainly hope to be able to support your request, and I see that OB Council did support for last year, and that's a good thing. So thank you for the detail.
The question I have is, and that was kind of goes back to one of the original things I said to an earlier speaker about connecting this to OB and connecting it to our jurisdiction, and not geographically. When you read this, the kind of service you do is overwhelmingly. And it's necessary. It struck me this kind of service ought to really be part of our healthcare program. And it ought to be funded either through that or through VIHA. And is it because their inability or refusal to do that? Because that's really where the health, mental health, physical health, lies, because other than that, if they're not doing their job, it means downloading for us.
Yes.
And it's just when I read this, it feels like a download from the province to the municipality, and which is very unfortunate. Because there, I can tell you, there's a lot of health organizations out there mental health, physical health, that are, you know, very deserving, and as deserving as yours. And yours is very deserving, no question about it. But it's the jurisdiction thing that I struggle with. It really should be the province of Iha who covers you, not the individual municipalities. It's just a thought. Yeah. Maybe you can address that, because that's maybe an issue that we may want to address at the estimates committee.
Yeah. Well, again, to provide a bit of context for that, and it relates again to the shift and downsizing and losing the crisis line. The crisis line we saw very much as a multi-level support because of the nature of its access. It was available to every citizen in the CRD. It played a role as in sort of almost, it almost played a first responder role. It was very much an interventionist role, and it had protocols that it developed with the mental health team, with the police, and that sort of thing, so that if we had to respond to crisis, we could do so effectively. And the shift now is, it is a different thing. Our focus is much more on the area of mental health, much more in the area of prevention and education. With U-Space, we do have that accessibility piece that's available basically to everyone who can access a computer. And we do some crisis work on that. It's nothing like what we did on the crisis line. What we're really hoping over the next 2 or 3 years is to be able to shift burden of some of the support away from the municipalities and to the province and BHAP. Because our focus right now is on youth, that puts us in a bit of a there's a bit of a chasm between DHAP, who's responsible mostly for adult mental health, and NCFD, who are mostly responsible for children. We're currently at a table with people from those organizations and the civil district, and we're looking at working towards a regional suicide prevention strategy, and hopefully through that how that will be supported. But for the past year, and hopefully for this year, sort of continuing a level of municipal funding, I think it demonstrates community support. It helps us leverage other funds. Helps us sort of have that flexibility at the table as well.
Yeah, I appreciate all of that, and that's one of the easy tasks you have for organizations such as yours. But you know, we're not getting the municipal auditor in. We're hearing noises that the municipality, certain organizations say, you know, we're overtaxing. But one of the reasons we're having that is because we're having to support organizations such as yourself that's not being properly supported at the provincial level. So that might be something for UBCM or ABICC to take up at some point. But just so you're aware, that's an issue for us, because Councillor.
I realize this question maybe should be addressed to Iha, but if someone phones the number in Nanaimo with a concern about suicide, I mean, surely those people refer them to mental health experts and to other experts.
Yes.
And Iha deals with all of that in probably much the same way you do.
We had, when we were operating the crisis line, we had protocols worked out with mental health emergency teams locally.
So I assume they still do.
Yes, we spent a lot of time. We spent 3 or 4 months working really hard to transition the service over to the NIMO, because it was really important to us that there not be any distress caused among the people who use the service about the change. And so DHAB can now phone the emergency mental health team in Victoria, the NIMO can phone the mental health team Victoria, and they will respond in the same way that they did before.
So the people that come to you are really not someone it's really a person, it's really not someone who is concerned imminently about suicide. If somebody came in to you on that, you would refer them to the other number?
If they phoned, yes, we would refer them to the other number.
So this is more training, this is more teaching people about, I'm struggling to try and figure out exactly what you're doing.
Well, there are two streams, and first I'll talk about YouthSpace, which is our web-based support to youth. And we have a website that has a forum, a chat capacity, which is a one-on-one chat with a volunteer, which is basically like the crisis line on the web. And they can link directly to a child and youth counselor. That's through a partner agency.
But this is somebody that's just troubled. They're not necessarily threatening suicide.
Or a lot of them are talking about suicide.
So if they're talking about suicide, why wouldn't you send them to the other number where there's all these teams funded by VHOM? I'm sorry, I'm not criticizing it. I just don't understand it.
It's because primarily they're youth, and they're not going to make that phone call. We do have protocols if it's a life-threatening situation. We have the same kind of protocols that we had before, so that we could send out help if necessary. But part of the role, especially with youth, and that's why we responded with the website, is that it's not that the services aren't there, it's just that the youth don't bridge to those services very well.
Right.
And that's part of the role the site plays. Because they can talk about it until they feel safe enough to go elsewhere.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other questions? If not, you have a question?
Just a brief comment. I just wanted to say I'm OPA's Child and Youth Committee Chair, and I really appreciate the work you do. I know I've heard from the counselors that at the middle school level that participate at our table that they are under an incredible strain. The number of schools they're expected to cover and the number of students that they're expected to provide counseling services for is astronomical and impossible, and they feel that pressure as well. And I'm grateful that there is groups like yours there to help. And that statistic is very disturbing. The BC Vital Statistics Agency statistic that this was the second leading cause of death among the age group of 12 to 24. It's very scary.
Devastating impact.
Yes.
And it just ripples through the community. It's not not localized. We are actually going more excited because we are starting to train and educate teachers and school counselors, and we are going to be going into Monterey.
That's really great. I'm glad to hear that there's some additional support to work towards more prevention. I think applaud you for the youth website. I think that's a wonderful idea and a very innovative approach. So good work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Motion to refer this testimony, please.
Seconded.
Discussion. All in favor? Opposed? None opposed. Thank you very much. Thanks for joining us and sharing that with us. We next come to North Henderson Resident Association, item 10. Last year they were given $500 and this year they have a similar request. Is there anyone from NHRA?
I move we refer this request to ask.
Is it unusual that they would start Ms. Walker with $400 already in their beginning of the year? Is it the kind of cash that we haven't had a lot of experience with community associations and funding? Do I read that right? They started the year with $400?
Did you
my understanding was, I think the last time a request of this nature was discussed briefly with us, that we talked about establishing criteria. And I just wondered if we are in the process of doing that. And through you, Chair, to Ms. Walker, I just wondered if we were in the process of establishing funding criteria for community associations generally.
That was referred to one of the other committees, and I can't remember which one, I'm sorry. And I haven't heard anything further.
Was that not going to be part of the grants policy?
No, I think it was, wasn't it? Which one was it? I think there was a request from council to look, and there was a small number of people to look at grants policy. And I think it was felt that there was one of the other advisory committees might be able to offer some help, perhaps. But yes, it is in the works.
Yeah, and Patricia's.
We'll make sure that it stays on the right rail.
Well, I think Patricia's a little busy at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely.
Delayed for a while.
And it can also be the subject of our estimates, discussions, and you know, these criteria, you know, they don't just happen overnight. You have to kind of have a close look at them and see how they apply in real circumstances.
Yeah, just I had one question that, you know, the regarding the criteria as far as whether they were a registered charity or nonprofit society, because should they disband, where do the funds go? Just a question surrounding that. So, I'd like to see us look at establishing criteria that would apply to all groups. I think we've heard that there are more community associations or neighborhood associations in the process of developing, so it might be a good time to get started on that.
Okay. You'll track that issue, Ms. Hilton, no doubt. Thank you. All right, it's been moved and seconded to go to estimates of it.
Yes.
Discussion, for discussion, all in favor, opposed, none opposed. Thank you. Thank you.
I
That's excellent. I just applaud your efforts. Thank you.
Thank you.
Actually, well, the thing that I find, actually, I personally live in Lyme Creek, and I've cycled from Lyme Creek for the past 12 years. I work in day to day when I work for the provincial government. And I found that the thing that really drives people to riding bicycle rather than taking a vehicle is the cost of gasoline. When gasoline spiked to $1.50 a liter. For years, I saw the same people on the Alpine Trail coming in. When it spiked, I saw a lot more people. And the interesting thing is that most people continue to build. And we provide the vehicles for Bike to Work Week for people for a safe environment to do that. And that's our goal. Our goal is to get people out of their cars, to remove the barriers to cycling. And we're doing that in a variety of ways right now. So.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Refer this then a motion to refer to estimates, please.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? None opposed. Thank you very much, Mr. Nelson. Appreciate you joining us tonight.
Well, thank you for your past support. Hopefully, your continued support will give me this opportunity.
Thank you. All right. And one more on the next page. We turn our minute agenda over. And this is the Victorian Vancouver Island Greek Community Society. Last year, we weren't able to see our way fit to approving any grant, and they're asking this year for $3,000. Is there anyone here from that organization? Maybe, I don't know if people want to entertain a motion to receive at this point, or some of there any, does that mean that unless there's someone who has some passion about changing what our policy last year was, which was no grant? Okay, move to receive.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, go ahead.
I wasn't here last year. Can you just briefly explain the rationale, Mary, regarding last year?
Well, it really was felt that this was more of a kind of a localized regional, well, it can't be both hands, but it really was something that didn't directly affect Oak Bay. It wasn't really within our jurisdiction geographically or otherwise. There's a lot of celebratory ethnic community organizations, and I think the feeling was that we didn't want to just center one out for some grant.
Thank you.
All right, we've got a motion to receive. All in favor? Opposed? None opposed. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Learning curve. Built heritage is something. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm
I
Thank you. Thank you.